Okay, good morning. Welcome to one of the greatest scholarly traditions at Hastings College. As you most likely know, the two people selected to present the ALS invited faculty lecture each year are nominated first by the faculty and then are selected by the students. So this lecture is a great honor, not only for the person chosen to give it, but also for those who are here to listen. Let me move over here. I'm especially pleased to introduce my good friend and colleague, Dr. Jeri Thompson. Dr. Thompson attended University of Nebraska at Lincoln, and she earned her bachelor's degree in psychology, as well as her master's and PhD in cognitive psychology with subspecialty, and let me get ready for this, human mental processes, such as visual and auditory perception, attention, memory, problem solving, and memory. During her 8 years at Hastings College, she has taught cognitive psychology, biopsychology, research methods and statistics, psychology of language, and animal cognition. All of this is not surprising, given the focus of her lecture today. What may, or for some of you may not, be surprising is that Jeri has many interests, both within and beyond the field of psychology. These include music and dancing, I think probably at the top of the list. We could ask her to demonstrate, but she would probably kill me. Science fiction, both reading and watching, history, scrapbooking, weeding, if you can believe it, she seriously weeded at my house, spending time with her grandchildren and her colleagues' children, animals, and language. I imagine this made it very difficult for her to choose a topic for today's lecture. But like all good liberal arts professors, Jeri combined several of her passions, a love of cognition or mental processes, language, research, and animals. So I'm sure it's going to be very exciting. Inspiration for Jeri's talk came from the cherished children's book, Dr. Doolittle, a character who had the ability to talk to animals and to understand animals' talk. In this presentation, Dr. Thompson examines what scientists have learned on the journey to understand animal communication, and also what scientists, and hopefully the lay public, have learned about themselves along the way. And now let's learn more about the search for the non-human Dr. Doolittle. Please join me in welcoming Dr. Jeri Thompson. I didn't make you cry. See, wasn't that nice?
You made me cry. I'm used to being in front of a bunch of people, but not with a microphone. So this is really weird. Good morning. Thank you, Dr. Furr. You said some things I didn't know you were going to say, but that's okay. We're still friends. Okay. What I'm about to share with you today is really meant to tell you just a little bit about a really huge story. And to tell you a little bit about my personal involvement in the story as a lifelong learner. My interest in language started way before, I think grade school. My nickname was, get this, Human Dictionary. Sounds really impressive, except that my sister's nickname was the Human Encyclopedia. So, yeah. We always had pets in my house. I never really thought much about them as far as cognitive processes go. So what I'd like to do is to start with a kind of whirlwind tour of some of the major thinking in human history about animals and their mental abilities. Now, this whirlwind tour covers millennia, so it's kind of like trying to explain Shakespeare in 10 minutes. So for the people who know a little bit about this in the audience, forgive me for any inaccuracies, or it's hard to get it right when you have to generalize so much over such a long period of time. Okay, I wanted to start with the cave people. Unfortunately, I'm sure they thought about animals a lot, but unfortunately they didn't write it down. And so we have to kind of skip them. I don't know why. So ancient philosophers. You recognize the name Aristotle? Okay. He's actually thought of as the inventor of what we now call zoology, the study of animals. He talked about a lot of things, a lot about humans, some about animals, but even back in before BC, before, animals were thought to have mental abilities. Okay, pretty general. Aristotle himself said that animals have perceptual abilities, which I don't think anybody even today would argue with. They learn, we know this too, because a lot of us have trained our animals, and they reason. That's getting a little bit up there with human cognitive, you know, the higher processes. Fast forward to the Middle Ages. I know that's a long, long time, a couple, you know, 1500 years or so. There was a really complicated relationship between animals and humans. I'll try to illustrate it briefly. To borrow Dr. Furrer's phrase, it was really complicated. On one hand, religious authorities, who really controlled most of the knowledge back then, reasoned that God put Adam in charge of the animals, so they must be inferior. One other piece of evidence was that, well, humans are the only ones who are upright and can look toward heaven, while animals are bound to looking downward. And so that must have some kind of meaning. On the other hand, like I said, it's complicated. This is a very interesting representation of a pig on trial. I know, it seems funny, but this happened more than you think. Animals did bad things, like, you know, turned over the garbage cans and attacked people, etc. And in the kind of thinking there was that this was might have been intentional. And even though animals couldn't, weren't in charge, they still might have had some evil intentions. And so in the background, you can see the judge and the jury in the jury box. The pig is in the front. It's a little hard to see, but there are tears flowing down the pig's eyes. And of course, the accuser on the right, pointing right at the criminal. This didn't always end badly for the animals. Sometimes they were found innocent, or innocent because of some circumstances, kind of, sort of, almost like some things today. If you are interested, I love history, so, you know, it was really hard for me to pack this stuff into a few slides, but there is a wonderful psychologist by the name of Nicholas Humphrey, who is in Cambridge, and he is known for his work on the evolution of human intelligence and consciousness. He was with Diane Fossey in Rwanda with the mountain gorillas, and he was one of the first people to demonstrate the existence of something called blind sight in human beings, which simply means that there are humans who are functionally blind, but yet they can navigate around objects, and there must be something about their brain that is helping them do that, even though they can't see. It's a really interesting phenomenon. Anyway, so more about consciousness later. Okay, fast forward again to the 1600s. A little-known fellow named Descartes. Some of you may have heard the name, a key figure in what became the scientific revolution about that time. Developments in math, physics, astronomy, biology, especially human anatomy, chemistry, just transformed our ideas of the laws of nature and led gradually to the appearance of what we know as modern science. Descartes had some pretty unmovable views about human nature and about animals. And since that's our focus today, all of animal behavior can be explained in mechanistic terms. This is not a drawing of his. I can give you the reference if you want. This is from a university in Spain where an artist tried to capture what Descartes thought, how animals work. They move, they make sounds, but it's all just machinery. It's automatic. There's no thinking, there's no consciousness involved. He relied a lot on an old theory called Occam's razor. Occam was a 14th century theologian who did a lot of thinking. I mean, up till now, a lot of this, everyone, is really just philosophical. I call it armchair thinking. You're trying to reason out the logic of the world around you. And so Occam said, yeah, we're over-interpreting some things. So you have to walk on the razor's edge and not over-interpret or under-interpret what moving, living beings are doing or thinking. Okay, that comes up again later. Okay, humans are capable of complex and novel behavior, not simple responses to stimuli. And that phrase comes up again later too. But we can reason about the world as we perceive it. We are capable of spontaneous speech that expresses thoughts. Descartes knew that animals make sounds that might be thought to constitute speech, such as a parrot requesting food, but he argued that these utterances were merely mechanically induced. Meanwhile, in another part of the galaxy, actually, it's fast forward to another galaxy. 1800s, Charles Darwin. I think that name probably resonates with just about everybody. If you don't know everything about how he changed the way we think about humans and animals, you probably know something at least. In his original reporting of how the mechanisms of change happen in nature, he made no mention of animals and compared to humans. That was later, and those two books called The Descent of Man and The Expression of the Emotions in Man and Animals really are what inform the area of study that I'm talking about today. To him, evolution simply meant change. What he provided was a mechanism by which this change happened. He knew nothing about genetics. So what we call modern evolutionary theory is kind of a combination of his ideas and more later understanding of genetics. So he openly discusses the evolution of human intelligence. He reasoned that the challenges of life, human or animal, require problem solving. Finding a mate, locating shelter, finding and eating food that won't kill you. He even observed and thought it was a miracle, and he was a believer in God, that earthworms seem to have this conscious, purposeful action. So, to paraphrase Darwin, faculties such as attention, memory, imitation, reason, of which humans are so proud, may be found in a primitive or even a well-developed condition in lower animals. And today, this way of thinking of there are animals who are not as evolved and animals that are higher evolved kind of is in the lay public consciousness. And it's kind of reinforced by a lot of things that we see on television. But it's probably not that simple. What happened after Darwin's books became popular and people out in the lay public and the scientific community started reading them was this explosion of anecdotes and informal observations about animals doing really, really cool and intelligent things. And it got to the point where everybody down the street had a story about how an animal did something that showed that it was intelligent, that it was thinking, that it could reason and problem solve. You all know some of these stories because we still do this today. A side question would be, why are we so fascinated with what they can do? George Romanes tells a story of watching an ant. He purposefully took a rock and put it on top of an ant to see what would happen. Not to kill it, but to see what the other ants would do. And here's a little bit of a description about what he said. His fellows rushed to the rescue. Some bit at the stone and tried to move it. Others seized the prisoner by the legs and grabbed with such force and pulled that I thought the legs would be pulled off. But they persevered until they got the captive free. Then he covered up another ant with a piece of clay, leaving only its antenna projecting. One of its fellows soon discovered it and bit off the pieces of clay until the ant was free. And he goes on with this, and in the end he concludes, I do not see how this action could be instinctive. It was sympathetic, such as man only among the higher mammalia shows. You get the idea. So there was a little backlash against this kind of interpretation of, well, not just ant behavior, but these informal anecdotes and stories that attributed human qualities to animals. The backlash. Somebody dug up, I'm exaggerating, Occam's razor, reformulated it, called it Morgan's canon. This was C. Lloyd Morgan, who was a scientist and a studier of animals. In no case is animal activity to be interpreted in terms of higher psychological processes. If it can be fairly interpreted in terms of processes which stand lower in the scale of psychological evolution and development. And there we see reference to that same lower, higher kind of hierarchy. Okay, I'm a psychologist. I cannot, in good conscience, talk about any of this without giving a shout out to my boys Wundt and James. Wilhelm Wundt was the first psychologist in Leipzig, Germany, at the University of Leipzig. Psychology didn't exist as a formal discipline before then. He was a real scientist. Psychology started out as the study of human consciousness. Many people don't realize that. For many years, there was no such thing as psychotherapy. It didn't exist. It was a laboratory science. James, a more of a philosopher than a laboratory person, but he was the most eloquent exponent of what we think we know about human thinking and consciousness. Problem was, Wundt was sort of using a technique that didn't really work very well. It didn't take long for everybody to kind of figure that out. He was training people to think about their own thinking. And there are several problems with that. The first is it's very subjective, and scientists like to be objective. It has to be verifiable. Whatever you observe has to be verifiable outside of the original observer. And unfortunately, try as he may, Wundt tried to train these people so well, but they couldn't agree on what they were trying to do. Every observer saw something or felt something or heard something different. So there was a shift in psychology. But right about that time, there was a really interesting occurrence that really had an effect on the rest of my story. Okay, I'm taking way too long with this. I said 10 minutes, whirlwind tour. Okay, Clever Hans is this horse's name. First decade of the 1900s, a retired German schoolteacher, influenced by all the popular books that gave all these stories of intelligent animal behavior, taught his, what he believed he taught his horse Hans to do math and to spell. He took great pride in presenting this to the public free of charge. After all, he was a school teacher. Periodically and regularly in the public courtyard of his town, he put Hans through his paces. Hans could apparently correctly answer math questions and could spell by tapping his right front hoof, among other behaviors. In this picture, Hans is in the courtyard. Von Austin, his owner, asks a math question. He raises the boxes to reveal two sets of pegs, then verbally asks Hans to add the two sets. And Hans did that by he didn't make very many mistakes. And this just amazed the crowd in Van Austin's hometown. The local press, however, accused him of fraud and asked for an investigation by the local constabulary. And so local VIPs were assigned to watch this horse and to watch Van Austin to see if he was secretly signaling the horse somehow. They put Hans through the most difficult tasks they could think of, but nobody could find any visual cueing that was going on. But in the audience was a psychologist who said, "We need further experimentation." Probably said it in German though, and I don't know German. What they did notice was the farther away the questioner was from the horse, the more Hans missed the questions. And when it started to get dark in the evening, the more Hans missed the questions. So they couldn't figure out what the visual cue was, but they suspected that it was. So for the next 3 years, the psychologist named Carl Stump and his students put Hans through tons of experimental procedures, trying to rule out all the variables that could explain his supposed intelligent behavior. Well, does anybody know the answer to this? Have you heard this story before? Clever Hans, it's a great story. He was doing something extraordinary, but it wasn't what it looked like. After 3 years of painstaking and detailed experimentation, turns out that people in the audience or whoever was doing the questioning made almost imperceptible movements. Leaning forward is one example. And then as soon as, for example, let's say Hans was counting to 10. Clop, 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 clop. Hans was a great perceiver, not a great mathematician. This becomes something of a real issue in animal research. Okay, behaviorism. Okay, soon after, all of this overinterpretation of animal behavior and intelligence and thinking led some American psychologists to say, all right, this is not science. This is too subjective. Let's take the smallest, easily controlled rodents we can find, because after all animals are the same. They're machinery. Recall Descartes. And let's see how they can learn. Yes, machines learn, so these animals can learn. And so we have the era of classical and operant conditioning in the history of psychology and animal research. So this is the stimulus response behavior that you all may have heard of. Pavlov's dogs. Raise your hand if you've heard of Pavlov's dogs. Okay, everybody knows about that. The implications of it are what's important for the beginning. This started this thinking that, okay, we should study the learning mechanisms of animals because they do behave after all, and how do they get there? The radical behaviorist said, thinking, language, consciousness, totally unnecessary to understand. don't need it to explain behavior. We can explain behavior with reward and punishment, or the association of two objects in an animal's environment. 40 years, nobody even dared to invoke the idea of consciousness and thinking in animals during this time. It became taboo to talk about it. It was assumed that animals didn't have anything of the kind. The idea that we attribute human-like qualities to animals is called anthropomorphism. This was one of the taboos. They aren't like us. Overinterpretation of their behavior, again, forbidden. But in the 1950s, all that changed. Late 1950s, European psychologists had been, European psychologists, by the way, were not that influenced by the American behaviorists. They kept on studying animals, and they did some really interesting work on human cognitive processes that had never been done before as well. That influence, Jean Piaget, Herman Ebbinghaus, and some others, did some really great stuff, and people were getting dissatisfied with these behaviorists. They demanded that you not talk about thought, even in humans. People were getting a little tired of that, because they said that this operant in classical conditioning can't explain behavior. Not of humans, not all of it, some of it, and we certainly are not making any headway figuring out what's going on in the animal mind. Finally, it was okay to say that. Anybody else know what in what field great advances were made? I'm sorry, I'm turning into my classroom behavior. 1950s, digital technology. What's this? Computers. Okay, that got people thinking about thinking. And the computer analogy for human processing became very, like a really enticing idea. Noam Chomsky, oh my goodness. This guy, a linguist, a nobody at the time, challenged one of the most famous behaviorists in history, B.F. Skinner, and said, okay, you can't explain human verbal behavior in terms of reward and punishment. Children learn too fast. They learn too much too fast. They cannot be just rewarded or punished for the right utterances or the wrong utterances before they actually start to create sentences, which is about 2 years of age. So all of these things opened up a really, really large door. Linguists' knowledge of the structure of human languages in general, and psychologists' emphasis grew and grew on human and animal mental abilities, led to some really, really interesting stuff. Okay, that was longer than 10 minutes, but you get the idea. Linguistics 101. Language is complicated. Part of the issue is non-scientists and the lay public is that aren't familiar with the finer points of how different elements of human language are defined and studied. As one modern linguist, Pullum, puts it, people know so little about language and how it works that they are prepared to believe almost anything about animal talk. Maybe by the end of this talk you will not have to worry about that. In popular use, communication of any kind, body gestures, we call speech or talking or language. Scientists have a definition for language based on what human languages are. We call those language universals. This is a representation, actually, of the structure of language. What's interesting about human language is that it's made up of smaller and smaller parts that can be then combined to create big, meaningful units. So we have a finite number of small units. Theoretically, the number of utterances we can make with them is infinite. I think that's the best organizing principle for trying to understand what's going to come next. So I'll try to remind you of that. Okay. So it's now okay to talk about human and animal cognition. We have speech. Animals don't really speak human languages, obviously. Unfortunately, we are not Dr. Doolittle. But here's a simple question that was asked at the beginning of this area of research. Do any animal communication systems have words, or the equivalent of words? We know that animals make sounds. Do they combine them like we do with our individual sounds of our languages into stable, discrete symbols with clear reference out in the world? Symbols. Words are symbols for objects and ideas. Semantics. Human languages have separate units of sound called words that have discrete meanings. This is a golden lion tamarin, one of the cutest monkeys you will ever see. They're tiny, tiny, and they run around and chip and chatter, and they're just really cool. When I was an undergraduate, I had the experience of recording some of the vocalizations of these beautiful monkeys, which are now endangered, by the way. They come from the rainforests of Brazil. And trying to help a graduate student in my at UNL try to interpret the vocalizations. That's not an easy task. One of the upsides of digitizing and computers is that we could see the sounds on a screen. I'll show you that in just a minute, and I'll have you listen to some monkeys. Unfortunately, I don't have any of those recordings, although this particular student went on to become a professor, and he is now at UNK. And he studied the sounds that these monkeys made as they were in response to their favorite foods. And yes, they did respond differently to different kinds of food. On the right are vervet monkeys. This was one of the first very systematic studies and widely known studies of monkey vocalizations. Okay, so remember, this is a start. We have to figure out what they're saying before we can figure out if it's organized like a language or not. What researchers Seafarth and Cheney found was that these animals had different calls for different predators. And what you see in front of you is a picture of the speech, if you want to call it speech, the sounds. This is the alarm call to an eagle predator. And what's interesting about it is not just the sound, but what they did when they heard it. And I'll get to that in a minute. I do want to play the sound for you. We'll see how well this works. It worked right before you came, so we'll see. Shall I play it again? Did you all hear it? Really short. Oh, pff. I'm muting the sound. That's going to help a lot. All right, so that's a picture of what you just heard. Okay, Now, this isn't a class on acoustics, but there are physical characteristics of that speech that can be interpreted in certain ways and show the complexity of the sound. Okay, here's the leopard alarm. And here's the snake alarm. If you look at the pictures, you can see that they look very differently. This is painstaking and time-consuming analysis. You have hours and hours of vocalizations. I mean, these researchers were not keeping these vervet monkeys captive anywhere. They were out in the forests with them, recording their vocalizations and their behaviors at the same time, because they wanted to link the sounds to the behaviors to try to understand what, if they had some kind of symbolic meaning. And this was their kind of the first attempt to understand words or segments of sound in animals. A really cool guy named Khan Slabachikov. Am I saying that right? Okay. Studies a species of prairie dogs called Gunnison's prairie dogs in Arizona. He's been doing it for 35 years. And he believes that he has also identified prairie dog words. Waiting. Commercial.
I'm not going to ask you again, sir. The new
waiting some more. Darn it.
We want those 10 grams of whole grain. Come on!
Making me hungry. How many of you have seen this before? All the students, not the professors. There's a whole series of videos online of a prairie dog actually making sounds that a British voice has been dubbed over. It is absolutely the most hysterical thing in the world. Don't have any video of Khan's prairie dogs, but what I can tell you is that they have done the most controlled, painstaking observations, recording of these animals' vocalizations. They have actually conducted experiments where they've introduced people by this time, a lot of the prairie dogs are used to seeing people because the researchers are always hanging around. But he's introduced people with different colors on. These prairie dogs are dichromatic, which means they can see some of the colors that we can see. They have different calls, according to Khan and his students, for the color of shirt that a person is wearing. They have calls that distinguish between wolves and dogs. They obviously have calls for other kinds of possible predators. What's funny about it is they don't run away from all predators. In fact, when a coyote comes strolling through Prairie Dog Town, they vocalize like crazy, but they don't move. Can anybody guess why? They got to keep their eye on him, because here's what the coyote does. Okay, we're not even talking about coyotes. What's this coyote thinking? The coyote kind of settles down and waits at the opening of one of the holes for some ridiculously dumb prairie dog who's hidden from it to stick its head out. Chomp. Okay, so the prairie dogs don't do that. They keep visible to the coyote. The coyote cannot enact its trickery. And so the whole time they're vocalizing to each other about where the coyote is. That's what Khan Slobachikov thinks. And he has some evidence to back it up. Cool, huh? They even introduced new stimuli that the prairie dogs had never seen before into their habitat, and the prairie dogs appeared to invent new vocalizations to describe them. Again, don't take my word for it. You have to read about. And they seem to rearrange some of their existing vocal patterns. Whoa. Okay, here's the part everybody's been waiting for, right? I brought my primate friends along with me. They usually sit in the office, but they were dying to get out for a while. I never take them anywhere. Clockwise starting top left, Washoe, the very first sign language signing chimpanzee. All four of these animals belong to a group called the Great Apes. Chimpanzees, orangutans, gorillas, and bonobos. Bonobos you may not have heard of. They are a new species of chimpanzee, but different from the regular chimpanzees. Okay, so on the top left, you see, I didn't pull up a video of Washoe. These are old, from the 60s. They're grainy, and you can't see anything. So I just thought I'd find a picture of Washoe. Washoe's American Sign Language name is making this movement above his ear. For, you know, my ears stick out, I'm a chimpanzee, right? And so that's what he's doing in the video. Me, Washoe, and he's looking in a mirror. On the right, top right, is a chimp called Nim Chimpsky, a ridiculous play on the name of Noam Chomsky, the linguist. He was also, they're both, all of these were raised in human households, or at least raised with human interaction every single day. Name is signing, hug me. Hug me. Coco, bottom left. Coco the gorilla. How many of you have heard of Coco? Okay. I do have a video of Coco, because for some reason, Coco seems to be the one you can see. You know, animals have really flexible hands and fingers and arms. They do a lot of stuff with their arms and hands. It wasn't hard to teach them, according to these people, sign language. They took to it kind of naturally. As a matter of fact, in the wild, great apes make lots of gestures naturally. And so they taught them sign language. Coco is a very large female gorilla who is getting older, so she sits still long enough that you can watch just her hands. Otherwise, in a lot of these videos, they're moving around, and then they make these signs so quickly that it's really hard to see them. Although if you put someone who is from the sign language community with them, they can read it pretty well. On the right, bottom right, is Chantek. Tantek is an orangutan who, they only exist in Borneo and Sumatra, and there's not very many of them left. This is a huge male. You notice the side pouches. Also raised by a human anthropologist named Lynn Miles. If you're interested in any of these animals, I can give you tons more information about them. Let's see what we can get from this video.
Who is that? Think later. Okay, that is you. Gorilla. Animal. Coco love. Okay. That's perfect. That is you. You are a lovely animal.
When you fast forward at Coco, that their intimate friendship will shatter century-old stereotypes and change forever our outlook of both gorillas and ourselves. Penny describes her friend with gentle honesty and affection.
Coco's about 5 feet tall. She weighs roughly 300 pounds. A little heavy for a female. The average is 250. She's a big female gorilla. Coco has a very strong sense of self. She feels she's important. She's got a strong ego. She's playful, can be very silly.
Sentence differs from this sentence dramatically, I might add. Kanzi is probably the most famous chimpanzee who has learned to communicate, but he doesn't know sign language. He has a vocabulary of what they call lexigrams, but that not even that is impressive. Kanzi was raised not and was not taught anything. He hung around while his mother was being Well, people attempted to train his mother. She never learned a thing, by the way. That points out that there are probably individual differences in the motivation of animals to work at this. Kanzi understands human speech. Can't talk to us, but can respond. And his person says, "That's me."
I have so much stuff, and we're almost out of time already. So I'm going to kind of skip. What you're missing is a video of this woman right here, Sue Savage Rumba,
who raised Kanzi, putting on a welder's mask to keep from doing the clever Hans cueing, putting on a welder's mask and asking Kanzi questions he's never been asked before about the objects in the room around him. And she says, Kanzi, can you please give the bear its medicine? Well, there's a stuffed bear over here, and Kanzi picks up the needle and pretends to inject the bear with it. So there's some aspects there of the patterning of words. Here's the million-dollar question, though. I know I'm conscious. Are you conscious? Why should I believe you? I do because we have language to talk about it, and we kind of have to trust. But I can never be quite sure, right? We think of consciousness as being awake. Scientists think of it in much differently. We have learned so much from studies of children, the development of human children. Turns out that even small children are not aware of themselves until a certain period in development. So we took a lot of these child development tests and used them. I say we, I didn't do it. We as scientists took them and applied them to higher primates and even some lower animals, and with some very surprising results. I'm gonna stop there. Let me take you to my very last slide, because the point I want to make is, take home. In the YTPM, your typical popular media, this is what you see. Take some advice from Descartes, that old 16th century white guy. Think about it. Think about what you're being asked to believe. Thank you very much.